Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you all for coming. It's a real pleasure to be here. I'm here today to talk about the archaeology of the Thames foreshore, and in particular looking at the site we've been working at on the Greenwich foreshore in front of the old Royal Naval College. I wanted to start off, though, by just giving you a little bit of background to our project and to why we do what we do on the foreshore. So it could be said that sort of archaeological interest or antiquarian interest on the Thames foreshore really began as far back as the 17th century, when we have this record in the diary of Samuel Pepys, where he records going to Blackwall to watch a dock being excavated and describes what we now know is a prehistoric forest or a submerged land surface being excavated. And you can see the quote there below describing what he could see as it was being dug out. What he was describing sounds very much like some of the things that we're seeing up and down the river now. So that the image that you can see there is from Erith, so out in the estuary. And you can see Dr. Sophie Seal, who undertook her PhD studies on this foreshore, looking at the remains of a submerged prehistoric landscape. Moving into the 19th century, we enter what has been referred to by John Cotton as the Golden Age of Thames finds. So this is the period when there's so much infrastructure being developed and changed. We have dredging, we have navigation channels being opened up, we have sewage works going in, we have bridges being built, as well as all of the railways and so on through the Victorian period. And this is the period when we're seeing many, many artefacts coming out and being collected by dredgermen. And they're being acquired by antiquarian collectors, and actually the collections of places like the British Museum and indeed the Museum of London, where we are now, a large part of the assemblages of those great museums and many local museums is formed of material that was collected during this period. So you can see on the slides here, we've got some examples of a very, very few of the different kinds of artefacts that have come out. So on the left-hand side, we have a group of Viking period axes and spears that were recovered in the area of London Bridge. And on the right-hand side, we have a whole selection of different artefacts. There's no prizes for guessing what the one in the middle is, because you all know, don't you, it's the Battersea Shield. We have a range of military items, spears, swords, daggers, and so on. We have shield bosses. We also have the more functional utilitarian items, including fishing weights, spears, and so on. Right at the bottom here, we have a wooden artefact. This is the Dagenham idol, found, no prizes for guessing again, in Dagenham. And it's a prehistoric idol, prehistoric artefact. And that's just to remind us that because we're working in a submerged environment, an area that is underwater twice a day, we're also very lucky in that we do recover organic material from the foreshore, as well as a range of metallic and other artefacts, so ceramics and organic material coming out. Moving into the 20th century, we've had some great names down on the foreshore. So Mortimer Wheeler himself, when he was director of the London Museum, did excavate on the foreshore in the 1920s up in West London at Brentford, sort of in between Brentford and Isleworth. Now, he recorded the remains of this feature here, which he interpreted as part of a hut floor. Now, we think it's probably more likely that he was looking at something intertidal rather than dry land. So rather than it being the remains of a hut, I think it's possibly more likely to be the remains of a collapsed fish trap or a wattle hurdle of some sort. So very interesting to be able to dig into the archives, and we're definitely treading in the footsteps of giants here. Similarly, in the late 1940s, Ivor Noel Hume was active on the London foreshore and all the way through the 50s and into the early 60s. Now, he created one of the first, if not the first, foreshore map, what we would now call an alpha survey map, essentially a field-walking diagram of the area in between Cannon Street Railway Bridge and London Bridge. Now, as you can see, he's marked on with little crosses all the different things that he was seeing on the foreshore, including my personal favourite, the River of Moving Mud. He's marked on items of all periods, so from the Iron Age, Roman, medieval and post-medieval periods, thereby sort of just emphasising a point that will come up later on. We are looking at multi-period archaeological sites on the foreshore. although finding dragons is somewhat rarer. This is the man himself, Ivanhoe Hume. Opportunity for me to have a little bit of hero worship there. For those of you who don't know him, he was active in the City of London. He worked for the Guildhall Museum. So the Museum of London today is formed from the London Museum and the Guildhall Museum. And Ivanhoe Hume worked for the Guildhall Museum, working on bomb-damaged sites after World War II alongside the Roman and Medieval London Excavation Council. Now, he felt very, very strongly about the archaeology of the foreshore and wrote a book called Treasures from the Thames, which is actually still, I believe, the only book about the archaeology of the Thames. And he said this, "The river cries out not for private collectors, but for local museums who can patrol their own foreshore and so preserve for the nation the treasure that still lies there." And that's something that we very much feel today. The involvement of local museums and particularly local communities is absolutely vital in monitoring and recording the archaeology of the foreshore. So coming into the 1990s, now during the sort of 1970s, 1980s and into the 1990s and still continuing today, there has been a huge amount of excavation along the London waterfront by bodies such as the Department of Urban Archaeology, Museum of London Archaeology and other contractors. So we know an enormous amount about the development of the waterfront, particularly in the City of London. We know that the river has gradually been effectively canalised, so moving the waterfront forward and forward and forward and embanking, and we can date those embankments from the Roman period all the way up to the Great Fire. But it wasn't really until the early 1990s that the foreshore itself started to be considered as an archaeological site in its own right. We have this background of antiquarian collection, limited investigation, some local archaeological societies, in particular the Wandsworth Archaeological Society, who monitored and recorded their own foreshore from the 1970s. But it was really in the 1990s that this all began to be drawn together under a more cohesive project. And it was the work of Richard Hill from University College London, who undertook his dissertation on the foreshore site at Chambers Wharf, at the bottom here at Bermondsey, and investigations by the Museum of London and University College London at Vauxhall, which really spurred the development of the Thames Archaeological Survey. Richard's work revealed that stratigraphy does survive on the foreshore, so that's layers of archaeology. You might not think in such a dynamic environment that we would be able to see layers of archaeology eroding out on the foreshore, but you can. They tend to erode out quite quickly, which is another theme we'll return to later, but they are indeed there. So we are looking at stratified archaeological sites. So Richard was looking at the remains of a post-medieval shipbreaking yard and also prehistoric archaeology just in this area of the site. Meanwhile, at Vauxhall, these timber piles marching out into the river there are the remains of a Bronze Age bridge or jetty going out into the water, probably to an island that has now disappeared. We don't think it went all the way across the other side because the river would have been about a mile wide during the Bronze Age at this point. So these two sites provided the impetus for the Thames Archaeological Survey, which was set up by Gustav Milne of the Institute of Archaeology and Nick Merriman of the Museum of London. It was funded by the Environment Agency and English Heritage and ran for 3 years. It was a very ambitious project, shall we say. So the aim of the project was to, for the first time, try and systematically map the archaeology of the foreshore. Now, by that I mean we did a lot of walking. We walked from Richmond to Greenwich and beyond, looking at what was on the foreshore and giving a number to everything that we could see. And by everything, I mean everything. The Sites and Monuments record were not so pleased when they found we'd recorded shopping trolleys. But they are archaeology, in my opinion. I'm not going to talk too much about shopping trolleys. Those of you who know me will know that there's a whole lecture there, but I digress. We did discover a huge range of very, very exciting archaeology, and I've just picked out a few examples of some of the sites that we looked at in slightly more detail. So at the right-hand side, you can see we have a wooden club at the top here. Now, if you would like to go and see the real thing, it is actually in the prehistoric gallery upstairs. This was recovered from the foreshore at this site. This is Chelsea, just in front of the houseboats, for those of you who know it, and came out of a peat deposit. So another one of these submerged prehistoric forests that I was referring to earlier. It dates to the Neolithic, and it looks like, a caveman's club. It has a handle a bit like a baseball bat, and the bottom looks like a cricket bat. What they were using it for, we're not entirely sure, but it has been suggested as a fish beater. It's a very large fish, I can say. Just coming back to this idea of multi-period archaeology, the club came out from this area just here. This structure here on the same site is the remains of a mid-Saxon fish trap, one of the best preserved that we have on the foreshore. And it's one of a number we discovered. So the number now totals, I think it's 10 possible fish traps within the intertidal zone. All of them so far date to the Anglo-Saxon period, with the exception of one Iron Age. Unsurprisingly, nautical remains, so the remains of shipbuilding or breaking or repair, were very common on the foreshore, including these two very large 18th century rudders recorded on the foreshore by the City of London Archaeological Society at Shadwell, and artefacts as well. This is a Roman intaglio, so it's the remains of a jewel from a Roman finger ring, and it was recovered on the foreshore in the area where Ivanhoe Hume produced his original map, and it's an image you may become familiar with, so it's now our project logo. Coming on to the Thames Discovery Programme. The Thames Discovery Programme began in 2008, so the Thames Archaeological Survey finished in 1999. We had a hiatus of research and community archaeology on the Thames, although there were obviously still a number of projects running, both through charitable organisations and through commercial organisations. The Thames Discovery Programme, however, was funded by the Heritage Lottery Fund, again as a three-year project, with the intention of revisiting and going back to look at all of those features that had been recorded during the Thames Archaeological Survey. Our funding ran out in 2011, and we are now part of Museum of London Archaeology, so part of a charitable trust based up in Hackney with the same aims and objectives. And here you can see some of our volunteers at work recording a ballast barge in Tripcock Ness. So this is, again, further out into the estuary. So what do we do? I've got feedback going on there. We run public lectures, we run workshops, regular guided walks, one or two a month, and an annual conference every year. For those of you who are interested, our next conference is in early November, well, mid-November actually, it's about a month today, and everyone is very welcome to come and hear more about what we've been doing. We also run the frog training programme. Now, that is not for amphibians, it's for people. The idea is that the frog is the foreshore recording and observation group. They are members of the public, anyone who is interested, who would like to come and learn more about the archaeology of the foreshore and to be involved in recording and monitoring that archaeology. We run training at the moment once or twice a year, and then we run fieldwork through the summer, so 4 to 6 weeks of recording and survey on the foreshore. And here you can see just setting up for recording at the site we're going to talk about today at Greenwich, recording the remains of a stair base at Trigg Lane, that's in the City of London, just below the Millennium Bridge, and recording the very fast eroding foreshore at Southwark, just near Bankside. So just in summary, over the last sort of 5 to 6 years, 6 years it is nearly, we've trained around 500 people to be members of the frog. We've recorded in detail over 1,000 features on the foreshore at sites, again, all the way from Richmond down to the Thames Barrier. We've organised well over now 250 different events on the foreshore and off the foreshore. We've won two British Archaeological Awards, including the award for Best Community Project, and we have a project website, which is really the hub of our sort of information. It's where we try and put all the data that we are gathering in blogs, form, in articles, and it's a website that is not just written by the staff, it's also written by members of the Foreshore Recording and Observation Group. It's a wonderful resource, and if you haven't had a chance to look at it, please do. We're very proud of it. We also make a great deal of use of things like Flickr, which is an online photo hosting website. We have around, I think it's over 3,000 photos on Flickr now, so if you want to know where I have been for the last 6 years, you can plot my progress across London photographically, mine and my colleagues. And we also make quite a great use of social media. So we do have a Facebook page and a Twitter page. Now, quite often we use social media just for silly things, things that make us laugh, things that we think will amuse other people. This is obviously not our approach to site safety, but it does make us laugh. But we do try and also use social media sometimes for slightly more serious aspects of our work, one of which is this concept of movement of sediment, or erosion, as it's also known. So about this time last year, we were tweeting Boris Johnson to try and get him to ask a question. Now, I don't know if you know that you can directly ask Boris on Twitter once a month. I think he still does it. And you can send him any question: what his favourite McDonald's meal is, how he did his hair in the morning, those kind of questions. You can ask him anything. He may not answer, however. And for about 6 months, he wasn't answering our question, which was, has the impact of increased river services on the fragile archaeology of the Thames foreshore been considered? Now, I'm all for river traffic. Getting about by boat is one of the best ways of seeing London. However, we did have a specific agenda, maybe, in mind when we asked this question. We asked and we asked and we asked. Until September last year, we mobbed him slightly. So we didn't just ask, but a whole lot of our members also asked, and other Twitter followers also retweeted this question. And we got an answer, and here it is. We always take account of archaeology, but river traffic is very low by historical comparisons. A very political answer. Factually correct, yes, there is less river traffic than there was in the past. However, it's the kind of river traffic that we were particularly interested in asking him about, and in particular, these vessels. Now, this is a Thames clipper. They are the fast ferry service, and here is Gustav Milne, still our project director today, behaving like King Canute and trying to hold back the waves as he records the archaeology. What we have noticed about the Thames Clipper is they do have a very particular kind of wash. The wash that's created by those vessels is quite large, and you can actually see it if you look on Google Earth. So here is the boat, and here is the wash. And you can see it as you zoom in. And here is the site at Greenwich. Here's the ferry pier. And there's a close-up. And there is the wake hitting the foreshore. And you can see the amount of sediment that's being disturbed as it goes past. So we are interested in the effects of erosion on foreshore structures and deposits. I should add that the main focus of our project is on foreshore structures and deposits. We are interested in how people have shaped and modified the surface in order to use it as a working area or for religious or ritual activity. So with that in mind, one of the key things about our project was to be looking at structures and how they have survived. Now, we have an archive of material from the 1990s. My apologies for the quality of this slide. This image shows the Trinity Almshouse stairs in Greenwich in about 1996. And you can see that the stairs have gone out of use. They've been blocked off, and this is what they looked like in the 90s. However, by 2009, they looked like this. By 2012, they looked like this. And this is from this year. Now, these are quite substantial chunks of concrete moving around on the foreshore, and suggests that there is some force behind the hydrodynamics going on this site. So it's quite a big structure to be coming apart, and it really is coming apart quite badly. So we've been looking at stairs. We've also been looking at the river wall in the same location at Trinity Almshouse Stairs. there are some reused, rather nice, reused stones set into the walls right next to the stairs. So the wall fabric itself is of historic interest. However, the wall is not faring particularly well either. This is a photo by the leader of the Greenwich frog team, Helen Johnston, taken just a few weeks ago, and shows that the damage to the historic fabric of the wall at Trinity Arms House stairs is now quite severe. What we do know is that once things start coming apart, they continue to come apart fairly rapidly. And this is not only an archaeological issue, this is an engineering issue. This is the flood defence for London. So this is not a good thing, in summary. So we've been looking a lot, obviously, at the harder structures, at the stairs, at the causeways, at the walls and so on. We've also been looking at the structures within, as I mentioned, the deposits on the foreshore. Now, as I said, we have an archive from the 1990s. So this site at Greenwich, in front of the old Royal Naval College, was a site that we did investigate in some detail during the mid to late 1990s, mainly with students from University College London. You can see, again, this is Gustav just here, and they're recording the remains of parts of a timber jetty here. Now, we were quite excited when we were working on the foreshore in the 90s because the jetty was believed to be Tudor, so it was in the press. We were all very excited, had its own headlines, made the tabloid press. We're very, very pleased about that. And the archive shows an interesting sight. So you can see we have the remains here of a structure coming out. We have some isolated piles on the foreshore, timber piles, and we have a base plate at the bottom here. And you can see that in slightly more detail there. So it's been wedged into the foreshore, so it appears to be in situ. Here's a detail of the what we believed at the time was a Tudor jetty. Now, I should add that we have no radiocarbon or dendrochronological dating on this structure at the present time, so this has been dated in association with the material that came up around it. So we were aware from the 1990s that we had significant archaeology on the foreshore at Greenwich, and it was a site that we wanted to revisit. Gustav published the site in the London Archaeologist in, I believe it's 1998, and you can see the various features I've just mentioned there. So we have our base plate, we have another piled structure coming out here, a series of timber piles running through here, and we have our jetty with a displaced pile here, and we have a brick-lined intrusion, I think he called it at the time, which has puzzled us for many a year. We will talk about that a little bit more. So it was one of the key sites that we wanted to reinvestigate as part of the Thames Discovery Programme. So we began in 2009, in June, with a guided walk, which is often one of the best ways of getting a really good overview, a sort of snapshot of the site, and particularly doing it with a group of people because everyone sees something different. So it was a very good way to start off our sort of reinvestigation of the site in 2009. One of the things that we noticed in 2009 was a series of timber piles, again, right at low water mark, in front of the old Royal Naval College, and something, we weren't sure what, coming out of the foreshore just above it. Very, very interesting, we thought. Certainly hadn't been there in the 1990s. Certainly something that was relatively newly exposed. And so we decided to investigate further. This is what the timber pile structure near the low watermark looked like in February 2010. Now, bearing in mind that none of these posts were visible in the 1990s at all. So this suggests that, or doesn't just suggest, tells us that the foreshore surface has dropped a considerable amount, 30 to 40 centimetres, in the intervening period. So what that means is we have lost that stratigraphy around those timber piles. Now, I will admit that it was this chain here, which has a very handy date on it, it says 1928, that made us think this is a 20th century structure. This is something quite substantial, fairly sort of chunky timbers. The chain seems to be near it. We think it might be 20th century. Okay, so we sort of parked that idea for a little while. We were quite interested in the little patch of timber that had been visible in 2009 and was again you can see, just coming up in February 2010. So it was starting to resolve itself into something slightly more substantial, right in front of the Charles II building at the old Royal Naval College. May 2010, it was still there, coming out a little bit more clearly. We gave it a little gentle brush, and it was, you know, it was definitely a something, as we like to say in the trade. But also in May 2010, there was another sort of series of timber piles. We're right in front of the Charles II building again, and there were more timber piles. And it was a bit of a period of time of it was there and it wasn't there, and then there was some there and then there was not there. And then they do come and go, movement of sediment. There is definitely sediment moving. So we asked Mola Geomatics, this is Neville Constantine, to come and help us with starting to survey the site. So recording using GPS some of these timbers so that we could start to plot them. We also ran our frog training and summer season fieldwork at the site in May and August 2010, and we managed to relocate the piled base plate, the base plate with the wedge still in it, and my boots, and a whole series of other base plates which weren't attached to the foreshore. So laid out in lines, seeming to be in relationship to each other, but not actually pegged to the foreshore. So they didn't seem to be in their original context. Without being attached to the foreshore, it's very difficult to see what kind of structural function they were sort of using them for. We also cleaned and recorded the remains of the revetment for the 18th century riverside wall. Now, again, ideally, you shouldn't be able to see the revetment of the 18th century riverside wall, because that does suggest that if you can see the structural elements for parts of the cofferdam and so on used in the construction of the river wall, suggests we're quite a long way down in the sequence. So really not good, and something that we've been continuing to keep an eye on. We refound Gustav's Tudor jetty here. This is Gus again and my colleague Elliot Ragg, who is our field officer, and we noticed that there is now an additional base plate, you can just see to the left of Elliot there, running along the top of the Tudor jetty structure, what we believe is a Tudor jetty structure. Also, more evidence for some revetments, including some masonry with mason's marks on, just to the west of the Tudor jetty. All in all, a very busy site, but what we were particularly interested in was this sort of area of timberwork that we'd been observing for, you know, 6, 8, 9, 10 months, which, as I said, kept appearing and reappearing. So on the 14th of August 2010, we actually marked it out with some big stones so that we wouldn't lose it again, because it was a bit like that. And here is Bridget, one of our frog members, making sure that we can relocate it the next day. So on the 15th of August, I had a guided walk group with me. So I went off to the other end of the site. And when I came back, it looked like this. Now, this is Marion and Helen and Chris. And they were responsible for investigating that patch of timber that we'd been seeing over a year or so. I should add that what we do on the foreshore is not formal excavation. We are limited by the terms of our licence from the Port of London Authority to only excavate about 3 inches down. It just turned out that this was about 3 inches down. How handy is that? A little bit of aggressive cleaning, we like to call it. Essentially, what was exposed was the remains of a U-shaped timber jetty. So this is the base plates of a substantial timber jetty here. And you can see the other piles and our 20th century mooring chain coming out behind them there. Much excitement, I think, was the safest way of putting it. And at that time, we were still thinking that this was one structure and this was possibly a second structure. March 2011, we went back with Mola Geomatics to resurvey the site. You can see the base plates have largely gone under again. They were reburied and they're only just starting to pop out again. There's a new line of piles appeared at the top of the foreshore here. And May 2011, another fairly substantial season of fieldwork, working in the area of the base plates without any pegs, I mentioned earlier, This area of the site, just for your interest, is now a scheduled ancient monument running from about the corner there across the foreshore in front of the Belloc Memorial. So as part of our work, really, on the site, it's highlighted the importance of the archaeology eroding out of the foreshore here, and English Heritage have scheduled it. It's one of only two scheduled ancient monuments on the foreshore. It's really the remains of the jetty that we were most interested in. And here you can see the frog reenacting a jetty. They're very good like that, the frog. They will reenact all kinds of things, bomb strikes, jetties, fish traps. They're very, very lovely. And you can see we've got this line of timber piles at the top coming out. You can see the base plates just peeking out here, and everyone else is standing next to a timber pile. So it gives you an idea of the sort of size of this structure. And by this point in time, we were starting to think, maybe this and this and all of this is all part of one thing. And at the time, we thought it was a medieval jetty, possibly 12th or 13th century. And I will admit to being quite excited about that. I'm a medieval archaeologist by training. To have a frankly stonking medieval jetty on the foreshore at Greenwich was hugely exciting, because we don't know a huge amount about what was going on in the manor of Greenwich in the 12th, 13th century. We know a lot about Tudor Greenwich. We know a lot about later post-medieval Greenwich. We know less about medieval Greenwich. In the 12th, 13th century, the manor of Greenwich was owned by the Abbey of St. Peter at Ghent, an alien abbey, a foreign abbey. And we wondered whether this very large jetty that we'd been recording was something to do with them, was something to do with import and export of material from the continent to a landing place at Greenwich. April 2012, we were by then quite convinced that we were looking at a single structure, and we've helpfully outlined it with buckets this time rather than with people. And you can see, again, the line of timbers at the top, the U-shaped base plates coming out here, and a whole series of timbers marching out into the water there. By April 2013, it looked like this. Now, because the erosion on the foreshore, the movement of the sediment here, is quite severe, you'll notice that these timbers, which had only started appearing a couple of years before, are now sticking up, again, 30 to 40 centimetres. And what we found was that these base plate timbers were starting to lift and move away. So they are washing away before our very eyes. By February 2014, so February this year, it looks like this. The erosion really is quite dramatic at this stage. All of the base plates, bar one, have now eroded away, and the back timbers are sticking out quite substantially, and the lower timbers are actually, they're a bit like wobbly teeth. So I think some of them are now going. So we went back in April this year to record again with our frog training team, and this is the sort of cleaned up picture of the jetty as it stands. So it's, as I said, a very, very substantial structure, around 40 metres in length. It does continue out under the water here. We have sent Mark from Geomatics out in his waders to try and find bits. And it is an enormous thing. However, our theories about it being a medieval structure were somewhat blown out of the water when Damien Goodburn from Museum of London Archaeology visited the site. Now, we had noticed that the woodworking techniques that have been used to construct this jetty could be described as somewhat archaic, hence the reason that we'd assigned it a medieval date. So the techniques that have been used to construct the jetty as we see it seem to suggest a date in the medieval period. However, Damien, with his eye of expertise, took one look at it and said, no, 16th, 17th century. Which still is really exciting, just not medieval. But it does mean that we can say we have found a Tudor jetty. The reasons that he suggested that are that there is a considerable use of elm in this structure, which suggests a late medieval or post-medieval date. And there is also some evidence on some of the lower timbers for pit sawing, which is a technique that doesn't come in until that period. So, again, we are waiting for dendrochronological or radiocarbon dating to fully refine the absolute date of this structure. But we are now happy, I think, to say It is a post-medieval structure, or Tudor structure. But watch this space, we could change our minds again. However, there's been an awful lot of work being done on this structure, and we have a few sort of new pieces of information to add to Damien's identification. What we have seen on the most recent site visit that I went on, and I should add at this point that the Greenwich Frog team are regularly monitoring the site and are going down and visiting once a month. So a number of these recent discoveries that I shall mention from here on in are their discoveries. We have noticed now that there appears to be two phases to this jetty. So this series of timbers running out through here is actually on a slightly different alignment to these timbers. So we may be looking at a structure which has at least two phases, if not more. And in fact, the foreshore around the Tudor jetty, or Stuart jetty as we're now calling it, has changed substantially. So we have a structure that was recorded just this year here, which I'll talk about in a moment. We have a very, very substantial timber sluice running out just here, originally recorded as a revetment edge because of these timbers here, or possibly a causeway, changing interpretation, but has now resolved itself as a very large drainage feature. This is the new timbers that were recorded just this year. This is James, Mike, Guy, who's here today, as well as Helen, Tim and Christine, who were the X-team, essentially. We have a cross-shaped jetty or part of a jetty here. We think it might be something that was braced diagonally. Again, we're not definite on the date, probably post-medieval. It looks post-medieval. It could be Tudor. It could be slightly later. We're still waiting to get a date on this one as well. And also, and this is again something that was originally recorded by the frog, the remains of a brick feature. Can you just see it just running out through there? So here is our causeway as was, now a sluice. The cross-shaped timbers are down here. The jetty is just over here. And here is a brick feature, which we think represents the remains of the Tudor riverside wall. So a very exciting discovery, and demonstrating that the Tudor riverfront appears to have been on a different alignment, as has long been suspected, from the later waterfront. Now, this has been discovered before. These holes through it are the remains of mudlarkers' holes. So in the period of time when you were permitted to dig holes on the foreshore, or the mudlarks were permitted to dig, they actually have gone through it here. And they made a very good record, actually, of going through those sequences. So we have some photographs and notes from that period. So this is the sort of working plan of the jetty and some of the other features that we have on the site. So you'll see the size of the jetty, and you see the area where we know we have further timbers. We haven't been able to accurately locate them yet. Very, very substantial jetty indeed. The revetment or cofferdam piles for the river wall here, our fragment of brick waterfront wall here, the timber sluice, and there's something else coming out here now as well. It's not really a case of, well, it is vanishing archaeology, but it's also appearing archaeology, so it keeps us on our toes, this site. Just to zoom out, if you cast your mind back to the published plan of the site in the 1990s, essentially that's these features down here, and you can see just how much more busy the site is now. So sort of 5 years campaign of survey and recording on this site has really recorded a huge amount more archaeology than was visible in the 1990s, suggesting that with the movement of sediment here, the erosion here is very significant. So between sort of 30 to 60 centimetres probably in places, foreshore deposits have been lost. So we think now that possibly these features here, this is the brick intrusion, this is the revetment line here, there's a series of timber piles marching out into the water here. We think this is to do with retaining the edge of something that was called the mud hole, so an area of a dock. Just you can see the mark of it in the riverside wall, just a bit further along. We've got the remnants of the original Tudor jetty, which we think potentially could still be Tudor, but not for the palace, as we originally thought, so something smaller. This area here we think represents the remains of sort of foreshore construction. So building up the foreshore using the recycled remains, probably of house timbers, so those base plate timbers that we saw before. As I mentioned, we don't think they're structural because they're not pegged to anything. So we think that those are, have been put down onto the foreshore and packed in with a whole lot of other material in order to create a working surface or possibly some kind of slipway. We have our timber sluice or drain, as I said, riverside wall. Fascinated to know what this is going to turn out to be. Later riverside wall, cofferdam, and our very, very substantial Tudor jetty. So how do we understand this site? How do we put it all in context? We've started to do a little bit of looking at the waterfront excavations in the same way that you would working anywhere in London, trying to put your site in context. And I should again, emphasise this is not just the Thames Discovery Programme staff team who are doing this. This is a process that is very much driven by the local volunteer group, by our frog team. So we know that there has been a considerable amount of excavation all around the Greenwich complex over the last 40 to 50 years. In particular, we were interested at looking at excavations undertaken by Philip Dixon in this part of the site, and excavations undertaken by Museum of London Archaeology in the car park over here. Philip Dixon was working at the site in the 1970s and excavated two and a half of the quadrants in the middle of the old Royal Naval College. And this is one part of his site, a site plan from the 1970s. Now, as you can see, he's recorded a number of different phases. The earliest phase is here in black. This is probably the 15th century palace on the site, and the succeeding phases, with these bay sort of areas representing the Tudor palace. So that's the early Tudor palace, Henry VII's palace. So Philip Dixon did a lot of work trying to relate what he was finding on the site to the historic drawings that we have from Greenwich. Further over, in the car park area, just to the east of the old Royal Naval College itself, Julian Boucher, my colleague from MOLA, excavated in 2005 the parts of the vestry rooms for the chapel for the Tudor palace. So right at the sort of eastern end of the palace complex. So we have those remains located. And Gustav in the 1990s had a go at plotting the line of the Tudor waterfront, as suggested by the fact that we had a Tudor jetty here. Now, we would probably push this forward a little bit now, given that we know we have, well, potentially have riverside wall just running through here. So pulling all of these different sort of pieces of information together, we've dropped Philip Dixon's excavations onto a GIS, and you can see that there's a little bit of tweaking still to be done. Essentially, this is the area of the chapel that this is where he suggested the chapel should be. We actually know that the chapel is slightly further over. Julian had just the edge of it, I believe, just there. So there's a little bit more tweaking to do, and it may be that there were more of these bays on the Tudor Palace than are shown in the historic drawings, which wouldn't be a surprise. So what is this structure? And I should stress that this is very much a work in progress, and very much I'm relating the results of other people's very hard work here as well. Recently, just because the internet is a wonderful thing, a gentleman called David Fletcher took some fantastic three-dimensional images of the Tudor timbers and put them on the internet. You can look up his work, and you can also spin a 3D version now of the jetty. Two of our frog members, Martin Hatton and John Late, have taken that drawing and have taken the site records and have been looking at the structure and trying to understand it further. So this is their work in progress, and you can see that they've identified where we have, this is the central part of the structure, base plates that we are now missing, base plates that we still have, suggested base plates here, and also these possible indications for something earlier coming out underneath this structure. What we think we have, as identified by John and Martin, is we think we have the remains of this structure here, which is the long jetty. This is shown on Wingard's mid-16th century panorama of Greenwich here. And also you can just see it peeking in to this early 17th century view here. So we think, and I'm saying just at the moment, that we have the long jetty. So a Tudor and later reconstructed, re-embellished, renovated, repaired into the 17th century, removed by the late 17th century. But there's a considerable amount more work to do looking at the waterfront. And in fact, when you put it all on a map, so you can see our possible long jetty, our other features here, what we'd quite like to do, if it's all right with the old Royal Naval College, is put a trench here, just so that we can check where the line of the waterfront is and Henry VIII's possible watergate here. Another trench here would be handy as well, just to establish the line of the palace and make sure that we're heading in the right direction. And just for good luck, we'd like another one there, checking, again, the line of the waterfront and just making sure that we haven't got any other structures we're missing. So that would be good. Just going to finish up very quickly by talking about some of the artefacts that have been recovered from the foreshore. Now, these are mostly chance finds recorded by metal detectorists, by mudlarkers. We have done a little bit more formal survey with the mudlarkers, but most of these artefacts that you'll see on the screen have just been recorded by chance. So again, a photo from Helen showing a rather lovely prehistoric artefact. Now, there is definitely some evidence for prehistoric activity on this site as well. This is a Mesolithic antler pick, which was found by Pete Waitman, a frog member and mudlarker. This is a rather lovely piece of Anglo-Saxon stamped Ipswich ware. I'd be delighted to find some more of this. It's actually, I say I'm a medievalist, I'm actually an early medievalist, so more Saxon would be great. And in fact, we do have probably two, Anglo-Saxon fish traps on this site at very low water. You can just see it marching out into the river there. We have taken some samples of these and they will be dated very, very soon. So potentially evidence for Anglo-Saxon activity on the site. Some really lovely, as you'd expect, post-medieval artefacts, some quite high status. These were both recorded by Laura Makelam, who is a mudlarker. This bone dice was recovered during survey with the Thames and Field Metal Detecting Society in 2013. And this is a fragment of an ivory knife handle, beautifully decorated, recovered by Celia Bailey, again during 2013. This is possibly my favourite find. This is a part of a clay pipe stem with a dragon or a crocodile on it. This is one found in Bermondsey by another one of our frog members and a mudlarker, James Ward. Now, these are rather wonderful artefacts with a fantastic story. They're believed to represent Sir Walter Raleigh being eaten by a crocodile. The crocodile could, however, also be a toothed whale, possibly reflecting the fact that during this period people were seeing, there was a sort of little ice age, so they're seeing a lot of creatures they hadn't seen before. Global travel is obviously developing. It's a link to the biblical Jonah story, but the most wonderful relationship of all is that between Raleigh and James I, who apparently hated smoking and sent lots of pipe makers away, who all ended up in Holland, who appear to have made these pipes in Holland, in honour of Raleigh himself. And their peak of popularity is around the 1630s. They've been found in Plymouth, in Bristol. We have the two from London and as far afield as New York and Riga. So this is an example from Riga. So I'd just like to finish with a few acknowledgements. Firstly, to the Heritage Lottery Fund for funding our work at the site for the first 3 years, for 2008 to 2011. To the Port of London Authority, who licensed us to work on the foreshore, and the Crown Estate as well, who have also additionally funded survey work at the site at Greenwich. To the City of London Archaeological Trust, who funded a season of fieldwork. And finally, and last but by no means least, to the Frog Team, without whom we would not know probably 90% of what I've talked about today. So thank you very much.